Hello everyone. Today we are going to discuss another important topic of clinical biochemistry, that is tumor markers. Learning objective for today's video are, first we will see definition of tumor markers, what are the properties of good tumor markers, then we will see classification of tumor markers, and in the end we will see each tumor markers in detail. To download lecture notes and other interesting stuff related to biochemistry, please visit website biochemistrybasics.com. The first, definition of tumor markers. Tumor markers are the biological substances which are synthesized and released by cancer cells or produced by the host in response to the presence of tumor. And most of the tumor markers are proteins. They are detected in solid tumor, in circulating tumor cells in peripheral blood, in serum, in lymph nodes, in bone marrow, or in other body fluids like urine, stool, and in ascitic fluid. Now, what are the properties for the good tumor markers? So, the first property is tumor markers should be present in or produced by the tumor itself. Second property is tumor markers should not be present in healthy tissues. Third property is plasma level of tumor markers should be at a minimum level in healthy subjects and in benign conditions. Fourth property is tumor markers should be specific for a tissue. It should have a different immunological properties when it is synthesized by other tissues. Fifth property is plasma level of the tumor markers should be in proportion to the both size of the tumor as well as activity of the tumor. And the last property of good tumor marker is half-life of tumor markers should not be very long. So these are the various properties of good tumor markers. Now, what are the various clinical applications of tumor markers? The tumor markers are useful for the screening of various diseases, for the diagnosis of various carcinoma, prognosis and for monitoring of the treatment of various cancers, and for the detection of recurrence of various carcinoma. So these are the various applications of tumor markers. First one is screening, second one is diagnosis, third one is prognosis, fourth one is monitoring treatment, and the last one is detection of recurrence. Now, classification of tumor markers. The tumor markers are broadly classified into four categories. First one is hormones as a tumor markers. Second one is oncofetal antigens as a tumor markers. Third one is various enzymes as a tumor markers. And the last one is tumor associated proteins as a tumor markers. First, hormones as a tumor markers. And the examples are human chorionic gonadotropin, calcitonin, and catecholamines. Level of human chorionic gonadotropin is elevated in gestational trophoblastic disease and gonadal germ cell tumor. Level of calcitonin is elevated in medullary cancer of the thyroid. And the level of catecholamines are elevated in pheochromatocytoma. So these are the various examples of hormones as a tumor markers. Second category is oncofetal antigens as a tumor markers. And the example of oncofetal antigens are, first one is alpha fetoprotein, that is AFP, and second one is carcinoembryonic antigen, that is CEA. So alpha fetoprotein level is elevated in hepatocellular carcinoma and gonadal germ cell tumor. The level of CEA is elevated in adenocarcinomas of colon, pancreas, lung, breast, and ovary. Now, enzymes as a tumor markers, and the examples are prostatic acid phosphatase. Second one is neuron-specific enolase, and the third one is lactate dehydrogenase. Level of prostatic acid phosphatase is elevated in prostate cancer. Level of neuron-specific enolase is elevated in small cell cancer of the lung and in neuroblastoma. And the level of LDH is elevated in lymphoma and Ewing's sarcoma. So these are the example of various enzymes as a tumor markers. Now, tumor-associated proteins as a tumor markers, and the examples are prostate-specific antigen, that is PSA, monoclonal immunoglobulin, carbohydrate antigen 125, and CA19-9. The level of T PSA is elevated in prostate cancer. Monoclonal immunoglobulin are detected in myeloma. CA125 is elevated in ovarian cancer, and CA199 is elevated in cancer of colon, pancreas and breast. So these are the example of tumor associated proteins as a tumor markers. This is the picture showing the most commonly used tumor markers for the diagnosis, prognosis and treatment of various cancers. As we have already discussed, AFP level is elevated in liver cancer, PSA level is elevated in prostate cancer, then AFP and HCG level is elevated in testicular cancer. In breast cancer, level of CA125, CA and HER2 level is elevated. Then CA level is also elevated in stomach cancer, colon cancer, pancreatic cancer and ovarian cancer. And the CA125 level is also elevated in ovarian cancer. So this is the picture showing the most commonly used tumor markers. Now we will see each tumor markers in detail. So the first one is carbohydrate antigen 125. It is a cell surface glycoprotein present during embryonic development of coelomic epithelium, and it is present in adult structures which are derived from it. CA125 is a tumor marker for the ovarian cancers. Elevated levels of CA125 are also found in approximately 20% of the persons with pancreatic and digestive tract cancers. And its level is correlated with the tumor bulk. Normal blood level of CA125 is less than 35 unit per ml. So that is all about carbohydrate antigen 125. Second important tumor marker is alpha fetoprotein, that is AFP. AFP is a serum fetal protein which is synthesized by the liver, yolk sac and gastrointestinal tract, and it is an example of glycoprotein. It is a fetal albumin and it has a similarities with the adult albumin. It is increased in the circulation of the patients with hepatocellular carcinoma, germ cells tumors, keratocarcinoma of ovary and in pregnancy with fetal malformations of the neural tube. So its level is elevated most commonly with hepatocellular carcinoma, and apart from hepatocellular carcinoma, its level is also elevated in germ cell tumors, keratocarcinoma of ovary and in pregnancy with fetal malformations. In adult males and non-pregnant females, normal value is less than 15 nanogram per liter. A value of AFP above 300 nanogram per liter is often associated with cancer, although levels in this range may be seen in non-malignant liver diseases. But the level above 1000 nanogram per liter are almost always associated with cancer except in pregnancy. So that is all about alpha fetoprotein. Its level is most commonly elevated in hepatocellular carcinoma. Another important tumor marker is carcinoembryonic antigen. It is a complex glycoprotein that is associated with the plasma membrane of tumor cells, from which it may be released into the blood. It is elevated specially in colon cancer and in adenocarcinoma of uterus. It is also seen in pancreatic, gastric, lung, breast and ovarian carcinoma. And its level is also elevated in various non-malignant conditions like cirrhosis, inflammatory bowel disease, chronic lung disease, pancreatitis. And it is also elevated in 19% of the smokers and 3% of the healthy population. That's why it is not a satisfactory marker for the screening of healthy population. But it is a good marker for the monitoring of recurrence and to see monitoring the treatment. So that is all about carcinoembryonic antigen. Another important tumor marker is PSA, that is prostate specific antigen. It is a glycoprotein. It is ideal as a tumor marker because it has a high tissue specificity and high sensitivity. So it is commonly used for the detection of prostate cancer. Its level is also elevated in benign prostatic hyperplasia and prostatitis, that is inflammation of prostate. It is useful in diagnosis and follow-up of prostate carcinoma, monitor the recurrence and response to the treatment. And the normal level of PSA is less than 4 nanogram per ml. Levels greater than 10 nanogram per ml mean cancer is likely. And the level or area between 4 to 10 is called as a gray zone, and about 1 in 4 chance of having prostate cancer in that. PSA in the blood, it exists in a two form. First one is the protein bound and the second one is the free PSA. So as the amount of free PSA goes up, the less likely it is that there is a prostate cancer. And when the free PSA makes up more than 25% of the total PSA, prostate cancer is unlikely. And the 10% of free PSA, that means cancer is likely. So that is all about prostate specific antigen. Another important tumor marker is beta HCG, that is human chorionic gonadotropin. So it is a glycoprotein synthesized by sensitive trophoblastic cells of the normal placenta. It has a two subunit, one is the alpha and another is the beta. Alpha subunit is identical with those of FSH, TSH and LH, and the beta subunit is specific for the HCG. And the serum and urine HCG level is increased in early gestation and peak in the first trimester, that is around 60 to 90 days. It is also increased in HMOL, choriocarcinoma and germ cell tumors, and about 60% of the testicular cancers secrete human chorionic gonadotropin. Normal value is less than 20 international unit per liter for the males and for non-pregnant females. And the level greater than 10,000 international unit per liter indicates trophoblastic tumor. Another tumor marker is CA19-9. So it is elevated in patients of gastric carcinoma, colonic carcinoma and pancreatic carcinoma. And it is used for the differential diagnosis of benign from the malignant disease. Another important tumor markers are estrogen receptor and progesterone receptor. So first we will see estrogen receptor. The estrogen receptor is a protein found in the nucleus of breast and uterine tissues. The level of estrogen receptor in the tissue is used to determine whether a person with breast cancer is likely to respond to therapy with tamoxifen, which binds to the receptors blocking the action of estrogen. So that is the importance of estrogen receptor in the treatment of breast cancer. Now, progesterone receptor. So progesterone receptor consists of two proteins which are located in the nuclei of both breast and uterine tissues. And PR has the same prognostic value as a ER, and it is measured by similar methods. The tissue that doesn't express PR receptors is less likely to bind estrogen analogs used to treat the tumor. So the persons who test negative for both ER and PR have less than 5% chance of responding to endocrine therapy. So that is the importance of estrogen receptor and progesterone receptor in the treatment of breast cancer. Now, breast cancer oncogenes. The first one is HER2-neo. So HER2 is a protein that stimulates the breast cancer cells to grow. Higher than normal levels can be found in some other cancers too. The HER2 level is usually found by testing a sample of the cancer tissue itself, not in a blood. So that is the important aspect related to the testing of HER2. And the HER2 test is positive in about 1 in 5 breast cancers. These cancers tend to grow and spread more aggressively than other breast cancers. All newly diagnosed breast cancers should be tested for HER2. So that is all about breast cancer oncogenes. Another important tumor marker is calcitonin, which is a hormone secreted by T cells in the thyroid gland. It normally helps to regulate the blood calcium levels, and normal calcitonin levels is below 5 to 12 picogram per ml. And in medullary thyroid carcinoma, a cancer of parafollicular C cells, blood level of calcitonin are often greater than 100 picogram per ml. This is one of the rare tumor markers that can be used to help detect early cancer. So that is all about calcitonin, which is a hormone produced by the C cells in the thyroid gland. Another important tumor marker is neuron-specific enolase. It is an enzyme and it is a marker for the neuroendocrine tumors such as a small cell lung cancer, neuroblastoma and carcinoid tumors. And it is most useful in the follow-up of patients with small cell lung cancer or neuroblastoma. Elevated levels of neuron-specific enolase may also be found in some non-neuroendocrine cancers. The abnormal levels are usually higher than 9 microgram per ml. So that is all about neuron-specific enolase. Another important tumor marker is beta 2 microglobulin, which is an example of plasma protein. So beta 2 microglobulin levels are elevated in multiple myeloma, chronic lymphocytic leukemia, that is CLL, and some lymphomas. Levels may also be higher in some non-cancerous kidney diseases. And the normal level is usually below 2.5 milligram per liter. Now, what are the various techniques to detect tumor markers? The first technique is they can be detected with the help of CLIA or ELISA, that is chemiluminescence and enzyme-linked immunosorbent assay. Second one is they can be detected with the help of immunohistochemistry, that is IHC. Third technique is PCR. Fourth technique is FISH, that is fluorescence in situ hybridization. And the fourth technique is they can be detected with the help of cluster kits. Cluster kits are the all-in-one kits which detect the profiles, patterns of various tumor markers, prototypes and constellations. So these are the various techniques by which you can detect the tumor markers. Now, what are the various drawbacks of tumor markers? So the first and important drawback is related to the cancer heterogeneity. Second is lack of specificity, that means false positive values are very high. Lack of sensitivity, that means false negatives are also high. In benign disease, like CA and CA125 are also elevated. CA level is also elevated in smokers. Normal persons also have a small amounts. And higher levels only with the large tumor volume. And some cancers never have a higher levels. So these are the various drawbacks of tumor markers. So that is all about tumor markers. These are my references. Thank you for watching. Please like, share and subscribe Biochemistry Basics by Dr. Amit. And don't forget to press the bell icon so you can get all the notifications from it. Thank you.